afternoon, all the faculty members. I'll be presenting a case on thyroid swelling, and I'm Dr. Nishtha from UCMS. So we had a 45-year-old lady who was married and Hindu by religion and a resident of Uttar Pradesh. She was illiterate and with the socioeconomic status of lower according to the modified Kuppuswamy scale. When she presented to the surgery department, she had a swelling in the neck for around 10 years. And the patient was apparently well 10 years back when she incidentally noticed a swell. Incidentally, her family members noticed a swelling in the front of the neck, which was around 2 into 2 centimeters to start. It had an insidious onset and gradually progressively increased in size to about 10 into 8 centimeters. It was not associated with any pain, fever, difficulty in swallowing, breathing, or hoarseness of voice. There was no history suggestive of symptoms of hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism, and neither at that time and nor currently. There was no history suggestive of any metastatic symptoms. The patient had a history of tubal ligation, which was done around 12 years back, and she had a history of tattooing done in the back, 10 years back in the region of the neck swelling. She was diagnosed with hypertension 10 years back and managed with dietary modifications and oral medication. There was no history suggestive of diabetes mellitus, tuberculosis, or tubercular contact, previous hospitalization, or irradiation to the head and neck region. There was no history of any similar swelling in the past. She's a married female and a vegetarian by diet with consumption of vegetables of the brassica family. She's non-smoker and non-alcoholic with a normal bladder wobble habit and a normal sleep-wake cycle. There were no allergies or drug addictions. She experienced menarche at the age of 15 years and has been menopausal since the age of 35 years. She was para 4, live 4, and with one abortion, with the last child is 20 years old. And she had regular cycles with normal flow at that time, and they lasted for about 3 to 4 days. The patient has been receiving amlodipin for the past 10 years, 10 mg OD, and her hypertension is under control. There is no history of a similar swelling amongst any of the family members, and there is no history suggestive of any MEN-related cancers, hereditary syndromes among any family members. So that's the history.
Could you just go back to the history? You said about brassica family. Is it very important? I mean, if people consume cabbage most of the time, unless it's in Germany where they're constantly in the winters when they take cabbage and radish, this is there. It's not really, you don't have to mention it.
Already,
okay.
Sir.
And it's menarche, not menarch.
Okay, sir.
What do you mention this? No history suggestive of metastatic symptoms.
Yes, sir.
What exactly you meant by those symptoms?
Malignancies of the thyroid, they generally metastasize to the lungs, followed by the bone, and there is metastasis to the liver and the brain as well. So for the lungs, I ask for symptoms of, the most commonly we observe pleural effusion, and there's a persistent irritant cough. There can be histories of hemoptysis and shortness of breath associated. For bone, I ask for any bone pain, for liver, we can ask for history suggestive of yellowish discoloration of skin and sclera. And for brain, we can ask giddiness, we can ask for any seizure activity or...
Is it common to have?
No, sir, I mentioned that the most common is the lungs, followed by the bone.
Is it common to have metastasis?
No, sir, it's unlikely. Just that there's a history
of... What about tattooing? Why do you take any history? What's the importance of tattooing here?
Sir, it's more of a taboo for the patient because they tend to take treatments which are not actually advisable.
No, so as a surgeon, would you be looking for something when a patient is tattooed?
Sir, there can be a risk of viral infections like
hepatitis.
Yes, sir.
Patient told you that she's taking amlodipin, as you said.
Yes.
What other drug history did you take for her?
Ma'am, any history any treatment, whether she was started on, whether she was worked up for a thyroid function test or something prehand, and whether
she was started
on... So
tell me the importance of drug history in a patient in whom you're suspecting a thyroid swelling.
Ma'am, I cannot understand what you're trying to...
So what I was trying to say was that you need to take drug history, that whether she was treated for any thyroid disease, one, and if there is any history of intake of goitrogenic drugs. These two should be specifically mentioned. Okay. Can move to examination?
Yeah.
Before we move on, there is a very sad news that we will share with you. One of the senior most surgeons of the country and the projected chief guest for our inaugural function, Dr. Sandeep Mukherjee, is no more. It's a huge loss personally for me, and I'm sure for the college. It's somebody who we cherished, we thought about, we've always looked up to. So I would request you all to kindly stand up for a minute's silence. Thank you. Om Shanti. He was supposed to be the chief guest for this conference, and he was very excited about it. He was on ventilator for a while, came out of it. He was tracheostomized, could not speak, but in gestures he gave a thumbs up when we talked to him about the fact that we are doing it after 11 years, the American College of Surgeons meeting, last one he did. And huge loss, and we very, very, very actually devastated. So, but the show must go on, and we must carry on with the conference. We will see what we can do about paying homage on behalf of the entire college, and on behalf of almost every possible surgeon in this country. An outstanding surgeon, outstanding human being. We all loved him hugely, and he was a constant feature of all our academic meetings. Sad loss. Please proceed. Thank you.
So I proceeded, after the detailed history, I proceeded with the general physical examination. The patient had a normal mentation. She was conscious, alert, and cooperative with a performance scale of 80 by Karnofsky scale. She was she had a normal build and nutritionally preserved with no micronutrient and macronutrient deficiencies. The hydration was adequate with normal facial features, normal eye examination. There was no pallor, icterus, clubbing, or pedal edema. There was no axillary or cervical lymphadenopathy. However, the neck showed a large swelling, and I have described it further. The vitals of the patient were stable, and with an emphasis on the pulse rate was 92 per minute, which was regular, good volume, taken in the right radial artery in the sitting position. The blood pressure was 132 by 82 per mm of mercury in the right brachial artery in the sitting position, with a respiratory rate of 14 per minute, regular, abdominal thoracic. She was afebrile to touch. Then I proceeded with the examination of the head and neck region. The patient with my formal introduction to the patient, I did it beforehand, but still. After my formal introduction to the patient and an informed consent and ensuring adequate privacy of the patient and with adequate exposure up to the nipple region, I examined the patient. And the inspection was done from the front, and I examined the patient first from a distance and then close, with the patient sitting comfortably on a stool. So the inspection showed a large visible swelling of around 8 into 10 centimeters, which was situated in the thyroid fossa, and it was slightly more on the right side as compared to the left. The lower part of the swelling was appreciated, and it was appreciated well when the swelling moved up with deglutition. The swelling had a bosselated surface with well-defined margins. The upper border of the trachea was visible, but the lower border was not. The trachea with the swelling showed two rows of circumferential dotted pigmentation about 1 centimeter apart vertically in the midline, and the swelling in the middle of the swelling extending to a length of 7 centimeters. There were no dilated veins in the neck or the chest. There were no scar marks, sinuses, or visible pulsations in the neck. I palpated the patient standing behind the patient and with the neck in slight flexion, and however the trachea, it was examined from front. So there was no local rise of temperature and tenderness over the swelling. The both lobes of the thyroid gland and the isthmus were enlarged. The swelling was palpated and was moving upwards with deglutition, and the size was around 10.4 into 6.5 centimeters. It had a nodular surface with well-defined margins. The lower border of the swelling was palpable, and the lateral margin of the swelling was extending beyond and under the sternocleidomastoid muscle. It had a variable consistency with soft and firm areas. The swelling was mobile in relation to the deeper structures, and the trachea was palpated in the midline. The Cocker's test for the tracheal compression was negative, and the bilateral carotid pulsations were palpated, but they were displaced laterally. The neck circumference at the most prominent part was 42 centimeters. And that is the swelling again. And so I examined for the cervical lymph nodes. There was no cervical lymphadenopathy. And I examined for the retrosternal prolongation, and there was the lower margin of the swelling was palpable, and there were dilated veins on the neck and chest region. I examined for the toxic signs, and the pulse rate was normal, good volume and regular. There were no tremors in the hand, and there were no eye signs present, which I examined at the level of the eyes of the patient, at the level of the patient, and from front. Thereafter, the systemic examination, the chest examination, and the perabdomen examination was normal, along with the ear, nose, and throat examination, with examination of the scalp and spine, and everything was grossly normal. So I'd like to summarize my case by saying that there was a 45-year-old lady with a painless, gradually progressive swelling in the region of the thyroid fossa, which gradually increased in size from around 2 into 2 centimeters to a size of around 10 into 8 centimeters over 10 years. It was not associated with any pressure symptoms, no symptoms of hypo or hyperthyroidism, and she is on hypertensive medication currently, which is under control. Her general physical examination and systemic examination was grossly normal. On examination, there was a 10.4 into 6.5 centimeter swelling, which was involving both lobes of the thyroid gland and the isthmus, with a nodular surface, well-defined margins, variable consistency, mobile in relation to the deeper structures, with the trachea in the midline extending under the sternocleidomastoid muscle and displacing the carotids laterally. So the clinical impression is that there's a 45-year-old lady with multinodular goiter, clinically euthyroid, with no pressure symptoms, no retrosternal extension clinically, and most likely secondary to a benign etiology with hypertension under control. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, Dr. Sohani? You got the mic there.
So it's a multinodular goiter.
Yes.
So how will you like to proceed?
Okay, before that, any questions pertaining to the rest?
You talked about mobility of thyroid. So what kind of mobility were you looking for? One, you said it's moving up on deglutition. Other than that, you said it's not fixed to the underlying structures. How did you say that?
Ma'am, we fix it to the we keep the trachea fixed, and then we move the swelling upwards and sideways along the vertical and horizontal.
How do you keep the trachea fixed means?
We move it over.
So what I want to ask you is, which mobility is given more importance?
Intrinsic
upwards
mobility.
And downwards, or side to side?
Ma'am, side to side.
No, side to side. Trachea moves with the swelling, no? So that is why when you look for intrinsic mobility of thyroid, you have to see it in up and down direction, right? And anyways, if it's fixed, it will not move at all, and that means
it's moving on deglutition would rule that out anyway.
Yes,
no? And what you did Cocker's test here. You did Cocker's test here?
Yes, sir.
It was negative, you mentioned.
Yes,
no? How do you do that?
So Cocker's test is done for swellings in which bilateral enlargement of the gland, and we do not compress from both sides. We do one at a time. So
one at a time is you
like
got it right.
It
one is a passive hand, the other is an active
so
hand. We push against it. Otherwise, as she rightly said, trachea can be moved. So you can get a false test.
Yes.
But don't compress from both the sides, because that can produce.
Every patient will have stridor. So.
That stridor can happen in all of us.
Yes, sir.
So that's not important. Then you mentioned about retrosternal extension. What test did you do for that?
So the lower pole, the lower margin was palpable. So as such, I didn't need to do a PIMP.
You mentioned at some point prolongation not there.
Yes, sir. So I'm saying the lower border of the swelling was palpable. So as such, I didn't need to do a Pemberton's test. If the lower margin is not palpable, then we can go in for a Pemberton's test. And in that, we explain the patient what he has to do. So we ask the patient.
Okay, we're not asking how you do that. So Pemberton is done in patients who are symptomatic, they have orthopnea, or those where you cannot feel the lower border. That part is okay. Yes. Now, like the previous presenter, you did not mention about neck nodes.
I did.
That's what.
There was no cervical lymphadenopathy.
So she did mention that. So you mentioned about carotids getting displaced.
Yes,
where are they now?
Normally we palpate.
Where are they now?
Laterally displaced.
Where did you palpate them?
The carotid pulse.
Could you palpate carotid in this patient, or it was palpated somewhere else?
Normally it is palpated.
No, here in this patient. Normally we know where it is palpated. Where did you did you palpate carotid in this?
Yes, sir.
Where? Normally?
Yes, sir. At the normal position.
No, you mentioned it is displaced. That's why I'm asking. So where are they palpable?
It is palpated against the bone.
In this case, it's not palpable at the right where you're looking for.
Yes.
Shai-shag next tubercle.
Yes.
That's what you're saying?
Yes, sir.
So where are you palpating it? Where are the carotids in this patient?
They were along the lateral margin, of, like above that, the tattooing that is present. Above.
No, you defined it to the region.
Medial margin, lateral margin of sternocleidomastoid.
Medial margin of the sternocleidomastoid.
Sorry?
Along the medial margin of the sternocleidomastoid.
You felt it along, you always feel it along the medial border of sternocleidomastoid, but where did you palpate in this case? You're saying no, not, it is displaced, that's why the question. Did you palpate carotids in this patient?
Yes, sir.
Where?
So more laterally than the.
Laterally where? Can it ever go beyond the sternocleidomastoid?
No, sir.
Why?
So because the thyroid lies deep to the investing layer of the deep cervical fossa.
Yeah, so it cannot go, then the gland, is the sternocleidomastoid also displaced?
So
it's a large goiter, no, that's what I'm asking. Is it displaced or it's at the normal position?
So the swelling is going on the undersurface of the sternocleidomastoid.
It will be on the undersurface only, Nishtha,
yes,
because we are pushing the investing layer away. And investing layer takes the sternomastoid away.
Yes.
It's the same thing. If you push the sternomastoid, the investing layer is also getting pushed. Yes. Where are the carotids in this? They are also placed laterally. Yes. But they'll still stay medial to the sternomastoid. You need to describe that. That's why we are asking. Yes. The examination is not about the theory that you can go back and read and discuss. What do you do in the examination is what you are asked. You could, appreciate movement on deglutition in this patient?
Yes, sir.
Do you got a short video of that? Why I'm asking you this question is because it's filling up the entire neck.
Yes.
And there's hardly any space for it to move.
Yes, sir.
So very often it may not be moving on deglutition, just because there is no space to go. You said it is moving on deglutition, so we take it as that.
Okay. Any question? You said Cocker's test is negative. If it was positive, what would what information would you get? What would you think of?
It is suggestive of tracheal compression, and there are compressive symptoms present in the patient.
So post-operatively, what will you be afraid of?
Recurrent laryngeal nerve
trachomalacia. And the management for that would be?
We'll come to the management, okay. But you should anticipate that. That's why it was asked. Any, we move? Now, what is your diagnosis? Can you go back again? Because we lost in between.
45-year-old lady with multinodular goiter, clinically euthyroid with no pressure symptoms, no retrosternal extension, secondary to most likely a benign etiology with hypertension.
Most likely secondary to a benign etiology means what? I mean benign in...
Benign in etiology.
Probably benign. That does it. With hypertension. You okay?
Okay with that, sir?
Now you can proceed. Yeah. What do you do?
So I like to first of all confirm my diagnosis. So we use the quadruple assessment, which is a detailed history and clinical exam.
We've done that, yeah. We discussed in the previous case.
Then we'll proceed with a high resolution, the imaging, which is a high resolution ultrasound.
It should be a high resolution ultrasound, not a routine ultrasound. What does that mean?
So a high resolution ultrasound is, it has a better diagnostic accuracy and...
Is there any role of any improvement on ultrasound in thyroid?
it improve?
High resolution is, the resolution would be better. We won't go into the theory of it.
Yes, sir.
Any role of elastography in these thyroid nodules?
Based upon the elasticity, elastographic studies, we can stratify them. If they are soft, then if it's soft and easily compressible, and it's more likely a benign etiology, and if it's hard and
you can grade it, and high resolution ultrasound and elastography can allow you to grade them based on that, and the risk of malignancy can be ascertained. You can again watch that YouTube presentation on thyroid, you will find it. I've described it, I put the various grades based on which you can make a diagnosis. Not always FNAC. FNAC may not give you, it can be false negative if you don't use it with ultrasound. In the previous case, we did not ask you, but such a case, it is necessary to do it ultrasound guided. It's in fact mandatory. Most FNACs are not done guided. Okay, shall we?
Then thereafter we'll proceed for the
this is a benign, that is colloid goiter, which is multinodular. Patient is clinically, biochemically euthyroid. How do you proceed?
So after the imaging, then we'll go in for a image guided FNAC. Prior to that, we should do a serum TSH, but nobody does TSH nowadays, so we'll do the entire thyroid profile simultaneously.
Nobody does means they can do it.
Yeah, we can do it, but generally nobody it's not
So for that, the term for that is, it is recommended to do the complete thyroid profile.
Complete thyroid function test altogether. And
we are not discussing why TSH, so we are going beyond it now.
And then
I said it's a benign swelling now.
Okay.
So management.
So in case of benign,
clinically and biochemically euthyroid. So that makes it a clear case, no?
Okay, sir. So then I like to do additional investigations to support my diagnosis, like I'll do an indirect laryngoscopy to see the voice modulation studies to assess the vocal cords and the prior voice prior to surgery. Then I'll do an X-ray soft tissue neck, anterior posterior view and lateral view to assess the position of the trachea. And since it's a large swelling and though there's no retrosternal extension clinically, but there may be some retrosternal extension, so we can go in for a CCT of the thorax. And
is it indicated in this patient?
No, sir.
You are not willing to even do a Pemberton.
Yes.
And you want to do a CT.
Clinically, it's
the indications for CT in thyroid swellings. You dropped a question, so.
If we are suspecting retrosternal extension, and if we are suspecting a malignancy based upon the imaging and the FNAC report of the patient. And
recurrent disease and remnant disease. These are the indications. So you don't do it routinely. No?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Why did you specify that you want X-ray neck only for soft tissues?
To see the position of the trachea.
Is that all we are interested in? Supposing while you're about to position the patient on the table for surgery,
yes,
and the patient has got severe spondylitis, cannot be positioned. You must know about that beforehand. X-ray neck has to be done, and for these two reasons.
X-ray soft tissue neck is for the trachea. But you need excess cervical spine for, that's for surgeon to know.
Yes.
Soft tissue is mostly the anesthetist trying to find out. And with a CT, if you are doing it, then you don't need it because you will be able to get a better idea of the whole thing.
Yes.
How will you manage it? What is the treatment offered?
So the treatment should be guided based upon the patient's concerns.
This patient, can you show the picture? What are her concerns? What can be her concerns that are different?
So the main concern the patient has was cosmesis.
Okay.
So
will that be enough, patient's concerns?
No, sir.
Can you counsel the patient based on what you have observed?
No, sir. It's a
what can go wrong to this with this swelling?
So she can develop compressive symptoms later on in life, and there is a 5 to 10% risk of malignancy even in multinodular goiters, and the patient may not be able to follow up also.
Is that the only problem? Anybody? Can it become toxic?
Yes, sir.
Later?
Any nodule can become autonomous.
So this one, the gland, multinodular also can have one.
Is the reason for toxicity in multinodular goiter? Autonomicity, is that more common? What is more common reason for toxicity? Which region of multinodular goiter is hyperactive? Is it the nodular area or the internodular area?
Internodular.
So toxicity is a possibility, no?
Yes.
So toxicity can happen, malignancy can happen. So therefore, what would you advise the patient?
So we will advise a total thyroidectomy.
No, can she do without surgery if she walks into your clinic?
No.
So where is the concern coming here? Which concern is you looking at? Isn't it beyond the cosmetic problem?
Yes, sir.
So we should be more clear with that.
I think cosmesis can only be considered in a case of solitary nodule. Okay. When patient may be concerned about that. But here probably answer is very obvious.
Is there any role for medical management in such a goiter?
No.
Why?
Because it's a large swelling and because of the multiple risks involved with that swelling, so.
In a large, diffusely enlarged thyroid swelling and in a large multinodular goiter. Is there any difference in management? Do you think a diffuse enlargement of thyroid and a nodular enlargement, multinodular enlargement of thyroid?
A diffuse enlargement of thyroid can be due to autoimmune etiology like Graves' disease or...
Basically, in multinodular goiter, you will not consider medical because these nodules are not likely to regress because there is an element of fibrosis there which will not resolve, right? So management is surgical only. But in diffuse enlargements, medical management can be tried.
Okay. So you have ruled out malignancy, you investigate it. What do you offer there? Where is the trachea in this picture? Can you show it? Use the cursor. It's looking displaced. Maybe it's in the part.
It's okay.
Lower down, you could not appreciate
lower
it.
Lower down, you could not appreciate
it. Huh?
Yes.
Mm. So, how will you know whether the trachea is deviated lower down or not? Clinically examining?
So, we do the same three-finger test and then we palpate on both sides.
Three-finger you can't do here, no? That's why I asked you.
So we have to palpate on this.
It's not possible, no? The swelling is occupying that area.
Any other way?
We auscultate.
Right, we auscultate.
That's why you're doing a soft tissue, X-ray soft tissue neck. What surgery would you offer her quickly?
So we'll offer,
last minute.
We'll offer total thyroidectomy to the patient. And
and no confusion about hemi, the subtotal now, so total.
Total thyroidectomy and in case we are not able to preserve the recurrent laryngeal nerve and parathyroid, like if we are not able to identify them intraoperatively on one side, then on the other side we can leave a small sleeve of...
What is that called?
It's called the Hartley-Dunhill procedure.
Hartley-Dunhill, you can do in cases where you could not see...
It on one side.
Yes, on one side. But otherwise total thyroidectomy is the treatment of choice. Can you do anything less? You can't do that.
Yes.
And in most cases, that's how people go for. The concern for doing less than total has come on account of three things in cancers of thyroid. One is... They're very, relatively very benign, but nobody discusses the recurrent cancers. The recurrent cancers are not the same cancer, they're very aggressive. So that's one. Number two, the reason why the survival being good, they don't think it is necessary to cause damage because morbidity is quite extensive. And people who are doing it regularly, they prefer to do a total for this reason only. They get rid of the problem once for all. Because it is not that it'll remain confined to one side only. So therefore, most of the time your answer, you should be clear on this. Surgeons generally tend to do more. And when they talk of doing less than total in the Western world, their surveillance, their follow-ups are very good. So in a patient who is likely to be lost to follow-up and not coming back, but because we see them all coming back with very difficult cancers to manage. So that you need to take into account everything, holistic picture.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.